please take pictures. Yes. Right. Yeah. Please take pictures, record what we're seeing here today. Publish it widely. Because it's time for us to let those know who have the power to change legislation. We ain't playing no more. We ain't playing no more. We tired of this. Now, one of the reasons why the crosses are white with black writing on them is because that just represents the color spectrum. Because that's what my sister said. Gun violence, it's not color related. It's not age related. It's not gender related. Anybody and everybody can be the victim of gun violence at any particular time. And it's on your own time. Even right here, right now, today. Stay prayed up. And when you get off your knees, get up and fight. Make changes. And what we know is an unjust situation for some. Many people like to point at inner city crime. Some people call it black on black crime, gun violence. Like to point the finger at Chicago and say, look at how bad Chicago is. But the truth is, there's no city or town that's untouched in America by gun violence. South Carolina, we wretched when it comes to gun violence. Let me explain something right quick before I call my next person to the microphone who experienced this and who knows the pain. When we talk about Chicago, it's time for us to quit pointing a finger at Chicago, you see, because there are 5 million people that live in Chicago. 5 million people. That's how many people live in the state of South Carolina. 5 million people in the whole state. In 2015, we passed Chicago. Chicago had over 700 deaths. Statewide, we had over 800. 5 million there, 5 million here. We had 800 deaths, they had 700 deaths. Let's stop pointing the finger at them and let's look at our own selves and straighten our own problem out here and quit making excuses for what's going on in South Carolina. It's time for us to get up and do something about it. There are a lot of crosses here that are represented by people who unfortunately don't have someone here to speak on their behalf. So the crosses, and you all are speaking on their behalves. But some of the crosses that are here, their loved ones who were left to grieve are here. And the first person that I'm going to call to the mic right now is a very close friend of mine. Someone who will share with you something that I can't share. Someone who was a part of a club that he never wanted to be a part of, and the admission fee was too high for anybody to pay. Someone that I know and love dearly. I'd like to call my friend Osei Chandler to the microphone.
Osei! Greetings. On August 27th, 7 o'clock in the morning, my oldest son Azigwe called me from Brooklyn. From, I don't know where he was, to tell you the truth. But he called me to tell me that my beloved grandson, Mal Chandler, that he was killed the night before, just a few hours before. Shut up, I was in the bed, I shot him. Don't tell me that, don't tell me no stuff like that. I didn't say stuff. Don't tell me that. But the deal is he did. He and a group of his friends, most of them were nerds, good, by that I'm just saying good students, were coming from a party that was given at a club that one of the fellas' uncle owned, just for teenagers. They were approached by two other fellas, one of which had a gun in his pocket, and decided to bust through the group from the... It was on Fulton Street in Brooklyn. I know we're talking about South Carolina, but that boy was growing up right here. So Fulton Street between No Street, between Bedford and Franklin. So the bust through the crowd, say what you're doing, what you want to know, pull a gun. Actually, he took on some bags, some garbage bags that were on the ground. It's late at night, 2 o'clock in the morning, maybe 1 o'clock in the morning. And he got up and shot my grandson 2 times. Oh, one in the chest, one in the head. The only good news about that is he didn't suffer long. I want to tell you this part, though. Even though they didn't leave our grief, which is still ever present, we were able to get the murderer, and 2 years later we had a trial. The district attorney told me and my son that some of the witnesses that came forward at the time were now not willing to come forward again and put the whole trial in jeopardy. But because my son knew his son's friends, and because I knew some of their friends, we were able to contact them. One of the fellows was in Delaware, going to college. But man, he don't know if he can get back. He was hemming and hawing. But I knew this guy's father. I talked to his father. His father said, "What's up?" I told him. He said, "We'll be there." I called another fella who was living up in Buffalo, New York, going to State University of New York, studying engineering. He said, "I don't know, Mr. Chandler. I got midterms coming up next week. I'm going to be an engineer, and this stuff is hard." I said, "Oh, that's very good, son. I'm glad to hear that." My grandson wanted to be an engineer, too. He wanted to be an architectural engineer. But he can't do that. You need to come forward, speak up, let these people hear how you talk, how you can articulate. Let them see you, see what kind of fellow you are, because they're trying to portray you as thugs. Kind of like Donald Trump does, saying everything black is thuggish. But that's not the case. Bottom line is, we got four of those five guys to come forward. We spoke to four, and another fellow heard about it and stepped forward as well. The trial took 10 days. The jury deliberation took 20 minutes. They had to come back 2 weeks later. And a young man, his name is Claude Ward. You can Google any of this. Kamau Chandler, Claude Ward. He got 18 years to life. Every day in that courtroom, the whole back row and half of the next row were filled by his friends and acquaintances. Schoolmates. My son Chell told him, "Don't miss school, that's to come out here for this." But so some days we might have had 12 people, some days we had 18. We had a full house. My friends, Chell's friends, were all there to help convict us. And after the sentencing, we had an opportunity to speak with one of us. So Chell spoke. My son, I swear, he got more chutzpah than I do, because he commiserated with the shooter's family that they lost someone as well. I couldn't do that. I can't do that now. And I'm not saying I don't ever want to be able to do that, but I'm not feeling it right now. So I say this to say, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, know your children's friends. Know their parents if you can, okay? Not that it can stop anything, but it can help a situation, maybe. That's all I can say. That's it. Thank you very much.
For those who are so insensitive as to just watch a TV newscast about gun violence, or hit or type in a condolence on a Facebook post or something of that sort, I'll tell you, you see it. The hurt is real. The pain is real. And we cannot trivialize the pain that so many Americans are feeling today due to gun violence, due to violence itself. We can't trivialize that. And thank you so very much, Oscar. Is Monica? Chris, what's going on? You see a few words?
How you doing? That's the music.
I'm gonna call Chris Rainey up. Okay, although we had one testimony on domestic violence, this is my friend Chris Rainey. Another one who has a tragic story. And I think the purpose, and I know the purpose of this rally, is to hear the stories and not to let them just be pushed by the wayside. Christian Ray.
Good afternoon. How y'all doing today?
Good.
Well, just speaking on gun violence, 10 years ago, I lost my mom and my four siblings to domestic violence. They were murdered by my mom's husband, September 30th of 2006. And, you know, what Pastor Dixon was saying as far as the hurt is real, and as far as when it comes to social media and condolences and things like that, like, the pain never ends. My family died 10 years ago, and I can tell you it hurts as much now as it did then. Because, you know, I'm moving on in my life. I have chapters of my life that I'm moving on to, helping other people. But at the end of the day, there's nothing that I can truly do to bring them back or to even fill a void that is missing in my life. There's a lot of direction that God has given me as far as, you know, helping out the community and trying to change just how we as a state address and handle domestic violence. But through it all, only thing I can do is try to save other lives. There's nothing I can do to bring their life back or anything that I can do to change any of that. And, you know, I just want people to understand that when we have community events like this, I would love us to see a bigger turnout. And like I told Pastor Dixon last year, when it comes to this kind of thing, don't wait until it's your family to decide that you want to be involved in this type of organization or this type of program, because then it's too late. We have to start being proactive instead of being reactive about it. We have to really get back in the community and start taking over our communities back and saying, we're not going to have any more gun violence. We're not going to tolerate any more domestic violence. These are no longer personal problems or none of our business. This is stuff that we have to be proactive about if we really care about the next generation and we don't want to see our kids or our family members perish. Thank you.
Victims of homicide, survivors of homicide, it is real. It's so real. Ruthie, y'all have to excuse me because I'm sort of going off script right now. We got a couple of minutes here that we can give to Miss Harrison, who I know and love, and she's got a story to tell. Please listen.
If I can help somebody, as I pass some time today, then my living won't be anything. My sister is Gisella Stanton, domestic violence. She was stabbed many times. My son, just before Mother's Day, and me, he was shot many times, right down here in Charleston, South Carolina. So I have a double of domestic violence and homicide. But as I heard, most of them got up here and said, you know, I joined an organization when I put my son down, Michael Hardy. When I laid him down, before the casting went down, they said, we ready to put him down. I said, not yet. Not yet. I placed him down, slowly put the casting down. And I whispered in his ears, hold on, cause mama gonna be there. Mama gonna join an organization. Mama gonna fight. And mama gonna see you through. Go ahead, son. Go ahead. I put my boy, cast it down. Lead him down. Then I tell him, I'll just take him. I black out. But you know what? I want all of you to understand that even though we lost our loved one, I lost my sister, domestic violence, I lost my son, homicide. I'm not giving up. That's why I joined this group. I formed this group mothers against crime, women support group, so we can support one another. Why is it different from other groups? Because we're going to be sisterly heard. If you like to join our group, please see me after. These are women. Women support group, not to fight nobody, but the mothers are the backbone of America. This group that I formed because of my son's death is going to help many mothers. Mothers, cry on, because we are going to win if we got to go all the way to the top. And I want to thank Pastor Dixon for this great opportunity of letting us find some way to curb gun violence. Yo, we got to find some way to curb gun violence. I just want to say thank y'all. I just want to say thank all of y'all for what y'all done in the community.
Thank you, Lieutenant.
When we get to the State House, we're not going to let him trivialize it at all. We can't let anybody trivialize it at all. The young lady that I called on a few minutes ago, Monica Jefferson, she lost her son, Malcolm, October the 7th, 2013. On the night of his birthday. He went out to celebrate his birthday. He never came home. The next time she saw her son was to identify him. This is real. This is very, very real. And there's so many other things. Does everybody have a cross? Please, I'd ask you, if you don't have a cross, please come get a cross. Please represent for one of these silent victims that are here. Please, please come forward. They're silent, but our stand can be the voice for every one of them. It should be the voice. It must be the voice. Because let me tell you something. Even though in cases where there's a conviction, I thank God with Osei Chandler that there was a conviction in Kamau's death, his grandson's death. But you see, justice is not going to be served for the victims of homicide until we do what's necessary in order to change law to prevent it from happening again. The family of Walter Scott, is any representatives here? I don't believe they are. They've had some things going on with the family, and they contacted me and said they probably weren't going to be able to make it today. But they are in full support of what's going on today. They were here last year. They're silent witnesses, but still here. The blood of Walter Scott cries out for justice, cries out from the ground for justice. And we cannot turn a blind eye or a deaf ear away from that call. Mistrials, hung juries, in face of clear evidence, you might not agree with me, but I know what I saw, and I know how my vote would have stood. Anybody that didn't, is seeing is not believing, I don't know what kind of mania that is. Make my kind of folks. Officer involved shooting. We need to make sure that our law enforcement officers know that there are people watching them through civilian review boards, through checks and balances to let them know that their actions, they will be held accountable for their actions when the evidence is as clear as it is with Walter Scott. It's gun violence. Gun violence. Damon, I'm going to give you a couple of minutes here. Because when we talk about police violence, especially police against African Americans, there's something that we need to hear and we need to know. That it's not anything new. This is systemic. This has been perpetuated not just in recent times, not just since 2000, but has a history. And our history professor, there emeritus here, Professor Damon Fordham, is going to elaborate a bit on that.
It's an interesting irony that we're doing this in this park today, because most people don't know that in 1919 you had the Charleston race riots on May the 10th, 1919, and in this very park, as a matter of fact, these riots were going on, and the great Septima Clark, a local civil rights leader, was right over there on Henrietta Street and had to stay in the whole night because of the cries of violence happening in the streets. Two African Americans were lynched that day right here in this park, William Brown and Danielle, you may find this interesting, William Doctor, who's a cousin of both of ours, as a matter of fact. Those men were lynched that day. And Anthony Crawford, a couple of years earlier than that, 1916, was lynched by a mob up there, a prosperous farmer. And I was showing Pastor Dixon the other day where the newspapers at that time said that basically all the people who were involved with that got scot-free. Now, we're fortunate in that we can meet here at a place like this today and celebrate the birthday of a gentleman who did what he could to make such things incidences in the past. And we could also be thankful that things like that don't happen quite to the degree today, 100 years later, as they did at that time. But as with this, what Pastor Dixon was talking about with the mistrials, as well as many officers getting off scot-free with this type of thing, we have to understand this, folks. That's not just a black problem. In that is a problem for humanity. Because if one group is not safe, all groups are not safe. And that has to be understood. Dr. King once said very properly about this subject, "The law cannot legislate morality, but the law can regulate behavior. The law cannot make a man love me, but the law can stop a man from lynching me." And a man who he convinced to do the right thing, a great president by the name of John Fitzgerald Kennedy, said on this same subject, June 11, 1963, "Those who do nothing are inviting shame as well as violence. Those who act boldly are recognizing right as well as reality." And an upcoming president would do well to mark those words. And with that being said, this is where you play your part in this. Too often, people will march after the fact. Too often, people will get on the street corner and complain about these things. But when you ask them, "Did you vote?" all of a sudden, can't hear a thing. This is where you come in. The people who are in office that would allow this type of thing, the people in office who would be lax on gun laws, the people who are in office would be lax on murders and this type of thing. This is where we need two things. Malcolm X said it best. Before we have voter registration, you have to have voter education. It's not enough to just go to the church and tell people you gotta vote. You have to explain to them how you vote for a senator or a city council member or a representative or a mayor or a governor and so forth. So once you get these people educated, then they go to vote. And then the people who allow for this sort of thing should be on the unemployment line tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Yeah. It's always amazing when you can tie in this things historically. Last year, a year ago, Coalition People United to Take Back Our Community had our third annual Stop the Violence rally here in Marion Square. And we went to the specific topic of gun violence because of the events that happened in 2015 with the killing of Walter Scott in April 4th of 2015. And then the unthinkable happened. Within 2 months of that, just a block away from where we're at right now at Mother Emanuel AME Church, where nine innocent people lost their lives to gun violence. by a shooter, technically. Some would say that the chapter is closed.
No, no.
But as we've seen with other victims and survivors of gun violence, is the chapter really closed? Well, I got somebody here that's going to speak next. Somebody who had a very close personal tie to one of those who lost their lives at Mother Emanuel on June 17, 2015. Would those who have the names of the victims from Mother Emanuel, would you please come up front with your signs, please? Daniel Simmons?
Someone had him. She has him.
Okay, you got all nine? Next person I'm going to have to the mic is a very close personal friend of mine. I really appreciate him. He's another person that I just don't understand where you get the strength to go on after having gone through the pain of losing someone to gun violence. Reverend Dr. Kylon Middleton, pastor of Mount Zion AME Church, right here in downtown Charleston.
We continue to call the names of those who were assassinated, murdered in Mother Emanuel AME Church. The Honorable Reverend Clemente Carlos Pinckney, the Bain Middleton Doctor, Cynthia Graham Hurd, Susie Jackson, Ethel Lance, Tywanza Sanders, Daniel Simmons, Sharonda Coleman Singleton, Myra Thompson. On this very historic day, we pause to think about the life legacy and the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King, who was a drum major for justice and an ambassador of peace. When we begin to reflect upon the last 19 months, we recognize that these have been the times that have tried the souls of individuals who live in the aftermath of what occurred on June 17, 2015. Lives have been changed forever, and there is no normal for those who are family members of the slain or survivors who have now come on the back end of crawling out of that church in pools of blood, stepping over bodies. Their lives can never be the same. Two minor children who survived that massacre, and now the verdict is in. A sentence has been rendered, but it is not over. Dr. King calls us to action. And as long as there are still loopholes, and I know we continue to semantically argue that point, there remains an opportunity for us to fight to make certain that whatever existed in the system that allowed an individual who should not have possessed a firearm to gain a firearm to come from Lexington County through Richland County to Charleston County to enact a heinous crime, that we now view as a nightmare. A wife who cannot fitfully sleep through an entire night. Individuals who were members of a church that were in a building who cannot hear balloons pop anymore, or a car backfire, or loud noises that causes them to go right back to the place where they once were in a room and almost lost their own lives. The gun issue is a real issue. We begin to polarize it by saying those who are for gun ownership,
their Second Amendment rights become infringed upon when those who then call for regulation somehow believe that through responsible enactment of laws that begin to protect us and legislate fairly uniformly and across the board policies and systems that individuals, all of us, based on those systems, if we then went through those rigorous scrutiny of tests or practices, would then be able to be vetted so that the hands that should not have a firearm never touches one. We have to send a strong message to Colombia, to Washington, that it is their job to protect the public interest. We elect individuals to represent us, and as we are rallied here today, and the unnamed individuals who are on these crosses, and those of us who have to go back to our individual lives, and I heard somebody say this earlier today, that until it happens to you personally, well, I am a witness that I was among the sea and cloud of those that heard of the violence that occurred in various places, schools in Sandy Hook, movie theaters in Colorado, nightclubs in Florida, colleges and universities in either Virginia or San Bernardino. I have been one of those who heard of those stories, mourned and felt empathy and deep sorrow, but went right back to my individual life. Until my friend and brother was assassinated in a church based on nonsense, hatred, and racism. It now becomes personal when it happens to you, to your family, to your loved one, to the extent that your life never becomes the same. We can't go back in the shadows. We cannot continue to suffer in silence. But now is the time. 2017 is the season. This legislative session becomes the mandate that we will not allow session to close in June without some sensibly enacted law that has been passed by our legislators. And so we plan to be in Columbia. We plan to engage through letters, through personal contact, through continued engagement, through lobbying, through pestering, through continuously reminding our General Assembly, our legislators, that our loved ones' lives matter. It hurt me earlier this week when the Senate and the House went back into session, and Pinckney, who would have been one had he not been murdered in that tragedy, he would have been reporting for duty. And so since he cannot speak for himself, he has left us, me, his wife, and others, to pick up the banner to fight, to make certain that these type of actions never happen again. So join us this year in activism and action, making certain that gun regulation comes to South Carolina. We must have universal background checks and sensible solutions for all. Thank you very much, Pastor Dixon.
Thank you. And thank you one and all that came forward with the remembrances of those we've lost. Never forget. Never forget. I went and picked up a few signs around before I bring up our next speaker. Terrell Jamar Miles was killed right before Christmas last year. I'm assuming year before last, 2015. Right before Christmas. Right after Thanksgiving. Him and another brother by the name of Armstrong. Should be a something else out there. Lincolnville, South Carolina.
dead. Merry Christmas, family. Nathaniel McKelvey, Columbia, South Carolina. Mother's a wonderful person. He was just starting a job. He's ready for a new life. Went out on his birthday and didn't come home. Sierra Denise Truesdell, my mother Tamika Myers. Some people try to tell her how she's supposed to grieve because she lost her daughter in 2013. Well, her daughter went to a club in St. George to celebrate her birthday. The next time she saw her daughter, and please forgive the graphic way I say it, half of her head was blown off. Shaquille Sanders and Ernest Richmond, Lincolnville, South Carolina, right before Christmas 2015. When does it stop? But we are an amazing city. We are an amazing part of Americana. It's called the Lowcountry. And in the face of adversity, in the face of all the bloodshed and the pain that we share right now, we have not only survived, but I think that we're stronger right now. Because sometimes you gotta have a little pain in order to get stronger. Weightlifters know it. You gotta push beyond the pain in order to develop the strength. And because of that, I do believe that our next speaker was given a position of prominence within our community to fulfill the shoes of somebody that had the position for 40 years. And them some big shoes. But the man I'm getting ready to introduce today is somebody who has very aptly filled those shoes and who has, in the period following a 40-year mayor, has made Charleston an even better place than it was before. Ladies and gentlemen, Mayor John Tecklenburg.
Thank you, Pastor Dixon, and thank you for keeping us alive. God bless you. So, I did find those shoes. I sent them home with Mayor Riley. I got my own shoes, you know.
All right, man.
My own shoes. You know, today I'm feeling this contradiction of emotions. Just a few hours ago, and many of you may have been present or even participated, we were in the really joyful parade, celebrating the life and legacy of Martin Luther King. And so many thousands of people came out in our city and participated, and we celebrate. We celebrate his work. And here, sharing the sorrow of these many lives that are no longer with us, and so senseless. I stand below this great American flag that symbolizes our country. Last night at the Martin Luther King ecumenical service, I talked about the dream that Dr. Martin Luther King had and how his dream has become inextricably intertwined with the American dream. In fact, at his famous I Have a Dream speech, Dr. King quoted our founding fathers, who, although thankfully we have the chance to continue to try to perfect our union, in theory, the founding fathers really, really had it right, that all men are created equal, and that our Creator has endowed us with inalienable rights. We all know they fall off our tongue, right? Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. What is the first inalienable right that we have as Americans? It's to be alive. It's life. This senseless gun violence takes that basic American right away. I mean, if you think about it, it's just plain unconstitutional in the most purest sense of the expression. And there are many lost brothers and sisters. We poignantly still feel the loss of our 9 brothers and sisters at Mother Emanuel Church. Don't send me another young man who can't even pass the gun test. You know, they didn't even give it enough time for them to do the background check, and that man came down here to Charleston and killed 9 people. I mean, come on. We're not asking for the moon. We're not asking for something that's, you know, crazy.
Yeah.
We're just asking that a basic background check be completed before a gun can be sold.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not rocket science, y'all. And the other thing that we want to ask the legislature this year, I don't know if y'all know this, but if you're caught, if Chief Mullen catches you with an illegal gun and you got arrested and convicted, the fine is like $1,000, if full fine. If you get caught again, it's still $1,000. If you get caught the 3rd, the 4th, the 5th, the 20th, the 100th time, there's no difference. You know, we could make some changes to our laws that make it a bigger penalty for those who are breaking gun laws in this state.
Say that.
I mean, it's not rocket science. These are simple, reasonable things that we're asking for. So I wish that the city had the authority to just wave a magic wand and pass the ordinance that would disallow background checks not to be completed or to add extra penalties, but this is one of those cases where the state legislature, even though they like to give local government control, they like to still stay in charge of things, you know, and gun control or reducing gun violence is one of those things. So Senator, a lot of weight is on you. Senator Kempson has been carrying the water on this issue, and unfortunately he's just one of 46 senators up there in Columbia, and it really is going to take a grassroots effort, not just out of Charleston but around this state, because there are a lot of state senators who are not quite as enlightened as our great Senator Kempson, and we're going to have to help Reverend Middleton, you know, talk to these legislators, convince them, and if we can't, folks, you know, maybe we need some different state senators up there. Maybe we need some different legislators that have a little common sense about this issue. It's just, again, what we're asking is so reasonable. It just blows my mind that that they don't get it. So let's all work together and convince our legislature that this is the year for some action. And I don't know if you want me just to go ahead and call the senator up here. I've kind of set the stage for you, Senator, and maybe not as well as Reverend Dixon might, but y'all, this is really a hero of this movement, and he really is. Senator Marley Kempson, he's terrific.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Mayor. It's always good being with Mayor Tecklenburg. We agree on so much, and beautiful wife, Sandy. They're a true asset to Charleston. I'm not happy to be here today. I am grateful for the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. We attended the ceremony last night where we heard a dynamic speaker, my good friend, Benjamin Crump Jr., who represents so many victims of gun violence. And this morning, I was at Royal Missionary Baptist Church, where we had over 500 people to come out and commemorate the 88th birthday of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And I appreciate Professor Fordham's words in observation of MLK Day. And so I'm not happy to be here because we keep doing the same thing every year and expecting a different result. That's the definition of what?
Insanity.
Insanity. I am hoping that this year will be different, but we are starting off the wrong way. This park ought to be filled because gun violence is an issue that impacts all of us. Black, white, young, old, poor, rich, all of us. South Carolina, in any metric, not just domestic violence, but gun suicide and officers killed with guns by civilians. In this country, we make up approximately 5% of the world. But in the United States, we own more than 51% of all guns manufactured. And so last year, as most of you know, in the aftermath of the Emanuel 9, and I pay particular, I'm particularly emotional today because of Reverend Middleton, who spoke about our colleague Clem Pinckney and all of the other 8 who perished just a block away, and the attempted murder of the survivors. Let's not forget the survivors. But in the aftermath of that tragedy, I filed sweeping, comprehensive gun reform legislation. I was denied a hearing on any one of the multiple bills that I filed. And I didn't go to Columbia to be an agitator. Reverend Dixon, we applaud you for your work. You've been consistent. Let's give him a round of applause. We appreciate your work. And all of these organizations, Moms Demand Action, Gun Sense, we want to applaud their work. Smurf and the many others out here. This is work. But I didn't go to Columbia to be an agitator. But even Dr. Martin Luther King recognized that sometimes we gotta agitate and create tension. It's healthy for a democracy. And so when they denied me a hearing on the multiple bills that I filed, I went to work. The House sent to the Senate a bill that would nullify any executive order from the President of the United States that dealt with gun regulation. You may recall our current president, President Barack Obama, issued several executive orders because it was within his power to do what he could to curb gun violence. South Carolina, the South Carolina House
overwhelmingly passed an unconstitutional bill to nullify the president's executive order. I killed that bill in judiciary, and if they sent it to us again, I'm going to kill it again. And then they sent to us a bill that would accept guns from the bankruptcy code. So get this, Mr. Mayor. We can take your home. We can take your car. We can take all of your assets. But the South Carolina House won't allow the creditors to take your guns. I killed that bill in judiciary, and if they sent it to the Senate, I'll kill it again. And then, of course, most of you read about this. This bill got by me, but not without a filibuster. They want to, well, they have done away with the CWP requirements for residents in Georgia. South Carolina has about an 8-page statute, shooting tests, written tests, training. In South Carolina, you have to take that if you want. You got to go through this series of hurdles. So we're going to do away with a 5-page statute that General Assemblies before me. I've been in the General Assembly. This is going on my 4th year. But the General Assembly worked hard to ensure that people were trained in gun safety, that people had the requisite background. But they passed a bill in the House and Senate to allow Georgia residents who have very minimal requirements. In fact, in Georgia, you can carry a handgun at 18 years old. At least in South Carolina, you have to be 21 unless you're in the military. But we've done away with CWP requirements for Georgia residents so people from Georgia can come in South Carolina. Well, I filibustered that bill, but here's what we negotiated. Because by this time, they understood we were serious. We negotiated hearings. Many of you came to the hearings all across the state. We started in Greenville, and then we went to Columbia. Then we went to Hartsville. Senator Gerald Malloy has been at the forefront of this issue, and we went to his hometown to discuss it, one of Clem Pinckney's good friends. And we came to Charleston. And what we discovered was the majority of South Carolinians are in favor, if you phrase it correctly, Caroline, the majority of South Carolinians are in favor of extended background checks. It's consistent with the Winthrop poll, where over 85% of the South Carolinians will support extended background checks. And so the testimony, person after person, even in upstate, was majority in favor of background checks. Now, where are we now? And how can you help? Because hearings is not legislation. And I want to give you an assignment, if that's okay, Pastor. And so we started, we started back in the Senate almost 2 weeks ago now. And there are two bills that have been filed. We need you calling. Gerald Malloy has filed a bill, and State Senator Mia McLeod has filed a bill. I am working across the aisle trying to see whether or not there is any will by anybody in the Republican Party to join us in common sense background legislation. Let's not allow them to frame the issue. We're not taking anybody's guns away. as a young lady who spoke earlier articulated, we are all well aware of the Second Amendment. I didn't get many A's in law school, but I got an A in constitutional law. And believe me, I'm ready to have a constitutional discussion about a seminal case on gun rights called Heller. And even Justice Scalia, in his opinion, recognized the state's ability to provide for reasonable gun regulation in their state. And so we welcome the arguments. Let's have the debate. But we allow the NRA to frame the discussion. To those of you who don't know me, I did not go to Columbia to hook and buck and bend over backwards to the NRA.
Amen.
I did not go to Columbia to spend all my time figuring out how I can keep my job. But I went to Columbia to do my job.
Amen.
And so it is incumbent upon me and the spirit of all of these lives and the unnamed people that should be, whose names should be on these crosses, to go fight, continue to create a little tension, to go agitate. There was some discussion, and I'm closing, because I got to get home to my little daughter. It's a holiday, and she, Daddy, where you going? You hadn't been home all morning. I left the house to be at a 7 o'clock breakfast this morning at Royal Baptist Church. And so I'm going home to spend a little time with Mama and my daughter. But they are 23 members of judiciary, we got to have a majority. So any one of these two bills, you pick one, we got to focus on it. And we need you calling the Republican members of the judiciary and call the Democrats. Because not all Democrats are in favor of this issue either. They have to hear from you. They have to hear from you. No excuse. You got to call. You got to write. You got to come see us. If we're going to do it this year, we have to all be engaged. And so for any bill to become legislation, it's got to get out of committee. And then it has to go to the floor of the Senate. We've got 46 senators, we need a majority. And then the whole process starts over in the House. And that's a major concern because that's the body that passed the three bills overwhelmingly that I discussed earlier. And so I'm going back up the road to Columbia to continue to fight. I'm unwavering. Doesn't mean I won't compromise, but I'm solid in my conviction.
All right.
And it's not a politically popular thing, but I don't care. I don't care. One thing that Dr. Martin Luther King died for was his conviction, and we need more people with backbone in our elected offices. I want to thank each and every one of you again. We got a lot of work to do. A lot of work to do. We can't sleep. We can't sleep. I'm not on Facebook anymore. I'm not on Facebook anymore. I've had to get off Facebook because of the threats that I have received for pushing this issue. But you can find me on Twitter. And our good friends in Columbia are watching people who threaten state senators and House members. And so you got to be willing to fight for something. And I'm willing to fight for this.
State Senator Marlon Kempson, y'all. District 42, y'all give it up. Before I go any further, I want to just thank everybody that's helped out today, okay? In particular, let's see. I got got some particulars. In particular, my glasses on, can't even see. The ladies of Lambda Nu Zeta and Iota Theta Sigma, thank you. Thank you all so very much. My other helpers, formerly from the Dixon for Senate campaign, Sue and Bobby Willis over here, man. By the way, and you'll understand why we're asking for this, I need for everybody to make sure that you visit our sign-up sheets over here, okay? There's also water over here for anybody that would like water. Didn't wind up as warm as I thought it was gonna be today, but still in all, we got water. We got drinks for everybody, all righty? Of the last three speakers that we just had, Reverend Dr. Kylon Middleton, who spoke of that power, that necessity of getting up and getting involved. Our beloved mayor, who as he spoke, you could tell that this gun issue has affected him to the point that he's really, really bothered by it. And then we hear from our beloved Senator, Marlon Kempson, who says that there is a better way, that he's fighting for that better way.
And y'all gonna get it, man.
And he needs,
what needs to be a move.
Some help. It is ironic as we look out to not see hundreds of people out here today. As we've seen over the last 4 years, it's time for us to get up off of our lazy behinds and get involved. You all are not the lazy behind people. It's those empty spaces out here. It just ain't right. You know I'm Pastor Dixon, right? So I'm gonna talk a little scripture real quick. And then we're gonna close this out and have prayer. There's a scripture that I stand firm on, and it's in the book of Proverbs, a book that's supposedly written by the wisest man that ever lived, Solomon, son of David. And it's Proverbs chapter 6, verse 6, where it talks about how we can get anything accomplished that we need to accomplish. Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, said, if you want to get something done, look at how the ants work. I don't know about y'all, but I've never seen an ant come after somebody that stepped on an ant pile by themselves. And I never saw a few of them come after that person. When one is threatened, all is threatened. When one life is threatened, all our lives are threatened. Violence anywhere is a threat to peace everywhere. And until we understand that, until we get up and get involved in this fight to change common sense legislation, then we're going to continue to bury people, to have crosses, and to have grieving parents. I'm tired of making funeral homes rich due to something that we can change. And so it's time. I have no problem against funeral homes, morticians, none whatsoever. But we need to stop giving our money over to them over something that we can change. Senator Kempson outlined it very simply about the gun legislation. And if we don't do anything, if we don't make the change, one thing's gonna happen. Nothing. The same thing that's been happening is gonna happen.
That's right.
Anybody disagree? So here today, my first call will be to that the senators, the Republican senators, Chip Kempson, Chauncey Gregory, and Greg Emery. I charge you by the four forums that you attended and by the hurt and the pain that's right here and about the blood that's calling forth from the ground of those that have lost their lives to gun violence, no matter who it was, where it was, or when it was, to do your job and change it so that we have a safer America where our children are safe, where people who go to the movie theaters or to church are safe, and where we don't have to worry about those who are not supposed to have guns getting their hands on guns and killing other Americans. Now is the time, people. But it's not going to happen unless we get involved.
I love them, but I got to go.
Yes, Senator Kempson said to call. But I challenge everybody not only to call, and that's why we have this sign-up sheet over here. We need to know that we have people who are ready to get up at a moment's notice. when he's presenting legislation, when Senator Malloy is pushing legislation that'll get up and go to Columbia and get in their face just like we're in his face right in our face right now. Take the white crosses there. Let's let them turn their eyes and their heads to what the pain that we see in front of us right now. Let them ignore that and then explain to the South Carolina public at large, their constituents, why they refuse to stop the violence. And if it's about them getting paid by the NRA, let them say that. I'm not gonna pass the legislation because I'm getting paid by the NRA. Man up, man up. But it's time for us to make sure that we make this place safer. For our generation, and for the generations to come. I don't think there's anybody here who would say today is a safer world than it was 10 years or 15 years or 20 years ago. 50 years ago. So there's a progression, right, of violence. It's getting worse. And look at that little one right there. When he gets to be 30 years old, what is it gonna be like then if we don't stop it now? What is it going to be like? What is the world gonna be like that they come up in? That these little ones. So the onus of change is on us. So as Senator Kempson moves forward with legislation, as other legislation is going to affect us when it comes to these guns, when it comes up to pass, I'll be passing out information. Those that can meet me in Columbia, please, don't just meet me there, beat me there. And I'll, cause I'm gonna be there, standing loud, standing strong, for every one of these white crosses that we have out here. And like I said, this is the short list of white crosses. This is the short list. Unfortunately, like I said, we only reach a small amount of people. But I do believe the small people can do great things. And if we are the ones that are called to change this legislation, then so let it be. Gun violence, closing the loopholes. You might say, well, that's just dealing with Mother Emanuel in that situation, but it's not. When people talk about Chicago and the guns there, guess how they get there? Through people who are buying guns online through the loophole. Through people who are buying guns from straw purchases. People who are buying guns from bad apple gun dealers. That 5% of gun dealers who are responsible for 95% of the guns that are used in crimes. When they say the guns are coming from break-ins, well, I tell you, it's a whole lot of broken cars with people with guns in them. I live in a community, or I used to live in a community, where you could buy a gun 7 days a week by somebody that didn't live in my community, just coming in, raising the trunk, and saying, you got $20. Pick out whatever you want. Until we address this as what it is, a public health epidemic, until we look at gun violence just as it is, that it can affect anybody and everybody at any given time, even right here, right now. Until we do what's necessary in order to move our legislators to pass common sense gun legislation, then all of these deaths that we see in front of us have been in vain. They have all died in vain. I don't know about you, but I'm not willing and I'm not going to let them, their deaths be in vain. I refuse to do that, and I will fight on till I have no fight left in me, until legislation changes. Until my children and their children behind them have an opportunity to grow up in a place where they can be safe wherever they are from some lunatic with a gun. Please make sure that you sign up before you leave here, okay? If you just want communication about what's going on, or if you want to be one of those volunteers that goes up to Columbia, okay? We need you. So now, do I have any clergy present? Looks like we've extended ourselves a bit. Y'all ain't standing for the prayer? It's all good. No, just please. Okay, I'm just playing. So I tell you what. Since everybody's so spread out and there's not a whole lot of us, please, I'm going to call you once again to come in closer. Get in close to where the crosses are up front.
Yeah, I'm gonna bring them in, bring everybody in closer. And
I have batteries done.
Since we don't have like a plethora of clergy here, like I would have hoped.
How long gonna bring the
I'm
fire?
Actually going to ask my good friend Dr. Middleton here to do the honors of praying over the crowd here and over our nation. Good friends from the city of Charleston Police Department that are here.
Yeah.
We work together.
Yes.
There is no schism between what we do, no division. We work hand in hand because the city of Charleston, Chief Greg Mullen, he acknowledges that we all need one another in order to fix these problems. And I thank you all so much for being here. Thank you, guys.
Let us pray. God, we thank you for everything that has been said and done in this place today. We lift up the legacy of Dr. King, and we thank you, God, for his dream and his realization that America can be great if we all come together. In every hamlet, in every city, in every area, we must begin to tear down the walls that divide us and be united by those things that we have in common. Our condition, our human condition, that continues to motivate all of us to pursue life, liberty, and happiness. We come today, O God, remembering all of those who have been somehow affected by legislators who are bold and audacious in the fact that they are willing to fight for common sense legislation. We bless you, O God, because we recognize that your hand is in this season. That based on our gathering here today, you said wherever there are two or three gathered in your name for a cause that you promised to be in the midst of us. So we ask you now, O God, to begin to hold us by the hand so that we might run and not get weary, walk and not faint. We may see this issue every step of the way. Realizing, O God, that if we don't get weary in this season, we will reap if we faint not. We believe that it shall be that legislation will be passed. We believe that it shall be that we will see the realization based on the fact that guns will not be rampant in our communities and lives will be saved. We thank you, O God, for the healing. Although it hurts every day, we thank you for the healing process that continues to occur within every family that has lost someone from gun violence.
Yes, Lord.
And then, God, we thank you for Pastor Dixon, and we ask that you continue to bless him, O God, so that he becomes a voice for these type issues that are often swept under the rug. Yes, and when we leave this place today, don't...
We're all gathered here in your presence, Lord, with arms open wide, with a lifted hand.
Man, that's a lot of crosses.
And with open arms, we welcome you to abide. Oh, Lord. We need your spirit, your Holy Spirit, right now. Oh. us your spirit, your Holy Spirit, right now.
Amen.
Spirit, fall fresh on us. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, fall fresh on me and you.
Let you know, I'm best friends with a young lady named Essence Geddes, who is best friends with this man's son. I met Walter through one of my best friends, and I had no idea that I would make that connection.
It's Charleston for you.
And when I sit and think about the state of our city, I'm reminded that there are so many things and injustices that happened, and we were on the coast and there was slavery, and it's ironic that we are in the position that we are now. It's ironic that we're dealing with homosexuality, we're dealing with all these issues, but there's hope.
Amen.
And it's not about the prestige, and it's not about the money, and it's not about the greed, but if someone would just stand up for what is right.
Bell rang on that note.
Someone, if you could make this a personal thing, I want you to connect with someone who did not come here. Someone who is totally unlike you. And I want you to be accountable for that person. Because that's what it's about. It's about caring for you. Love. Guns don't kill me. People kill people, because the trigger cannot be pulled unless someone's finger is on it. So if you please, I'm begging, connect with someone who's totally unlike you. Just get to know them, text them, Facebook them, but be positive.